The Phase I environmental site assessment can be a very complicated process, but the good news is that there's only 6 outcomes that can come out of a Phase I environmental site assessment. The first one is the best case scenario, which is no further action. That means that during the review of the Phase I documents, during the site visit, as well as the preparation of the report, there were no circumstances that were identified that could contribute or identify historical contamination or could contribute to a future contamination source related to the site. This is a clean bill of health. That means the transaction can move forward and also the transaction can be closed without any worry to the lender on lending the money to the property. The second outcome for the Phase I environmental site assessment is the presence of a recognized environmental condition, a wreck. And the wreck highlights the fact that during the report, during the investigation, as well as the site visit, that they have found either hazardous substances or petroleum-related compounds associated with that site. And that identifies a wreck being present with the site itself. Now, one common question is, just because there's a wreck on the property, does that mean the transaction can't move forward? And the answer is no, it doesn't. Just because there's a recognized environmental condition does not mean that the transaction can no longer move forward. That just means that during the review of the process and the performing the Phase I environmental site assessment, there are certain circumstances that were identified. Now, the most common next step after the recognized environmental condition being identified is to do a further action, which is a further investigation to determine what are the types of substances that were identified or what is the petroleum compound or product that was identified in the property to see if there's really the presence of those types of compounds in the property, specifically in the groundwater or the soil on the property itself. And that is what we call a Phase II investigation. Now, the Phase II investigation is geared towards the findings of the Phase I and specifically highlights the requirements or the concerns that were found in the Phase I environmental site assessment. So if it's a petroleum-related concern, meaning a former gas station or underground fuel tank, the Phase II investigation and the scope of work of the Phase II will be geared towards identifying specifically for petroleum compounds. Now, let's say there's other hazardous substances like dry cleaning solvents present in the concern of the property. Well, the Phase II investigation would be related to identifying and investigating to find out if there are truly dry cleaning compounds associated with the property itself. So the Phase II is directly related to the findings of the Phase I. And the Phase I helps identify those concerns based on the identification of the recognized environmental condition. The third potential outcome of an environmental site assessment is the material threat. And a material threat is something that is an obvious threat of an impact or a release to public health or the environment. In a real world scenario, that could be something like an above ground storage tank that is in very poor condition and rusted out, and that could lead to the liquids from the above ground storage tank falling out. Or in an environment where chemicals are being stored in plastic containers, there are no ways to secure it, or there are no lids on the liquids. And as a result, anytime with any impact on the property, the liquids could be released into the environment in terms of a spill. So that's considered a material threat that is observed during the site visit on the property itself. The fourth potential outcome of a Phase I environmental site assessment is called the de minimis condition. And the de minimis condition is an action or a condition that would likely not result in enforcement action and is also not considered a significant environmental concern. Now, in that scenario, the primary example that you can consider is something, for example, like a dry cleaner that may have existed 70, 80 years ago, or a example of contaminants being present in the soil or groundwater, but they're not above regulatory levels. Those are considered de minimis conditions in that it's likely not to enact any enforcement action and also doesn't deem a significant risk factor to the property itself. The fifth example of the Phase I outcome is a type of recognized environmental condition, and it's called a controlled recognized environmental condition, a CREC. And a CREC is an example in which a recognized environmental condition was identified in the past and a regulatory agency has been involved in approving and implementing the implementation controls of cleaning up that environmental condition. So usually what that basically means is that a historical contamination source was identified, regulatory agencies is already involved, they've already approved any type of cleanup actions or implementation that needs to be taking place, and it's currently actively in that process. So because of that, it's termed as a controlled recognized environmental condition. An example of a controlled recognized environmental condition is a former gas station. A former gas station with any type of contamination on it in which a regulatory agency was already approved or involved in overseeing the cleanup and have authorized the closure of that site. And as a result, they have implemented what's called a deed restriction on that site itself. In that scenario, there could still be soil and groundwater that might be contaminated, but because of the fact that the regulatory agency was involved in overseeing the cleanup and the actions afterwards of the site, it's considered a controlled recognized environmental condition, given that it also has a deed restriction on what would happen and what can be done with the property itself. The sixth potential outcome of the Phase I environmental site assessment is the historical recognized environmental condition. And the difference between a historical recognized environmental condition with all the other two other environmental conditions is the fact that with the historical, it means that there was a historical issue with the site, either a dry cleaner, gas station, something to that effect. It has been cleaned up and overseen by the regulatory agency, and they have closed the site without any type of restrictions, which means it's ready for even for residential use. And because of that, it's considered a historical recognized environmental condition. Again, the regulatory agency has been involved. They have approved the cleanup, they have overseen the cleanup, and they have issued a site closure in which there has been no limitation on what they can do with the site. For example, a deed restriction. And as a result, this site is free and clear, but the purpose in calling it a historical one is just to highlight the fact that there was a historical issue with the property, it's been taken care of, and there are no limitations associated with the site. An example of a historical recognized environmental condition is a former dry cleaner that was found to have contamination in the soil, in the groundwater, and even vapor. The regulatory agency opened up a case, oversaw the cleanup. The cleanup was done to the satisfaction of the regulatory agency, and they have closed the case with no deed restriction, with no limitations on what can be done, and the property is free and clear in that regard. That's an example of a historical recognized environmental condition. If you found the information useful, make sure you hit the subscribe button as well as the bell notification to make sure you're informed the next time we upload a video.